thank you, Paul. Just before I begin, I'd like to thank everyone that's here today. Big thank you to Mary Beth Anderson for coming on very short notice. It's much appreciated. Ms. Caitlin Bell Barnett, thank you so much for coming. This event really required a lot of collaboration, so it's awesome to see it all come together. Paul here, the Center for International Human Rights. It's really exciting. So just before I begin to introduce myself, my name is Joseph DeLuca. I'm the president right now of NAMI on campus here at John Jay. Among many other things, we work to destigmatize mental illness on campus, advocate mental health awareness by doing events like these. We do a lot of tabling, kind of letting the student body know that we're here, and also hopefully acting as a liaison to mental health services both on campus and in the community. And just another quick shout out to Paul, a big thanks over the last couple of months in becoming a NAMI on campus club. Him and the rest of NAMI have been very helpful in accommodating and really helping this come together. I know I've got a lot of shout outs, but just one more. One other person I wanted to mention was Gina, we have here. She's actually working on a project right now. It is an experimental short film on depression and mental illness. And there's actually a campaign going on to fundraise money for this. It's through the Indiegogo website. You can find this at indiegogo.com. And when you go on that website, you can search dark/light. We just wanted to say any contribution, even a dollar, go ahead, more, anything really helps for this project. And again, Gina's up here if you ever want to speak with her.
Yeah, I'd be happy to
talk
to folks after. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
And we're going to be here next year in this forum in April with the film. So
yes.
Come back to that event.
Yes, another great event.
We need to make it first, though.
We're getting there.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, sure, sure. And then just a little more in terms of myself before I throw it on to Amalia. Again, I'm a current student here in the BAMA program. I'm finishing my master's in forensic psychology. Very passionate about mental illness awareness, reducing the stigma on campus. And again, can't say it much. Thank you so much for everyone being here today.
So, hi everyone. I'm Amalia, for those of you that don't know. I'm a senior here at John Jay and the vice president of NAMI on campus. I'm so glad that so many people came out tonight, because I think a big part of combating stigma is being open and talking about it. So I'm so glad everyone's here to just hear all our experiences, and it's really great. So as Paul had told you guys before, Joe and I are gonna share our stories tonight in 5 parts. So there's dark days, acceptance, treatment, coping skills, and then successes, hopes, and dreams. And after each of these sections, we're going to ask a question to the audience, and we'll have time for each of these sections to take about 1 or 2 answers from the audience. And now that you guys have heard a little bit about NAMI and how our presentation is going to go tonight, I'm going to give the floor to Joe so he can start us off.
Thank you. Okay, so like Amalia said, the first part of this inner voice is talking about our dark days, so that's where I'll begin. So my dark days, if we could call them that, is predominantly during high school, about the ages of 14 to 17. And this isn't to say I didn't have dark days before then, or I haven't had pretty crappy days after that, but this is when they were most prominent and really difficult to deal with. And it was during this time where I dealt with social anxiety disorder and clinical depression. And really during this time, just very unbearable day to day, dealing with the anxiety, dealing with the depression. And real quick, for those of you who don't know, social anxiety disorder, when people think about it, you might think of like, oh, extreme shyness. But it really is a lot more than that, or at least it was for me in my personal experiences. It was just a paralyzing condition day to day. Just normal social interaction with people, greeting people, walking into a classroom, walking down the street, just feeling embarrassed or thinking people were criticizing me or all these other really irrational things. And even mundane tasks such as like making a phone call or answering the phone like ordering food somewhere. It was just a very debilitating condition to deal with and to kind of live with at that time. It really was a struggle. And really this culminated into a lot of things in my life, which kind of led to a pretty intense depression during high school. I mean, I would ditch out on so many plans with my friends. I'd make up the lamest excuses why I couldn't go to a party or I couldn't go out and see a movie with my friends. I didn't even go to my high school prom. I couldn't even bring myself to it. And really this isolation led to a lot of depression. I would stay home a lot. I'd miss a lot of school, so it really directly affected that, directly affected my schoolwork. I would do my best, especially on days in school when there's a presentation, to stay home. It's kind of ironic that I'm here now. And really, if I could kind of sum these dark days in one moment, just to kind of localize it, I remember there was this one moment in 11th grade. I'm going to give this presentation in U.S. history on, I don't even remember what it was. But I know I was prepared for it. I was so prepared at all my notes, but then the morning of, I just like froze. And I couldn't even get out of bed. I didn't even go to school. And I remember really vividly that night, just like going into the bathroom that night when I was about to take a shower and just crying and just thinking about all these things that I was missing out on and feeling really confused too. Like, why was this happening? I couldn't really link it to anything. I'm kind of a logical person. I mean, I think back to high school, I had a lot of friends. I wasn't bullied. There wasn't any trauma in my life. So it was very difficult on like a mental level too, like, why is this happening? And that kind of shifted to, well, maybe nothing's really wrong and maybe some people feel like this. And I think that's really indicative too of a theme of the larger picture of how I was able to hide it, like in the bathroom, I was able to hide it in certain settings and kind of keep this brave face outside and kind of hang out in the background so people didn't really notice what was going on. And yeah, just adding to this, it was just that struggle of not really knowing what was going on, who to speak up to, would I look crazy if I speak up, like, is this normal? And I think this constant thinking of questioning and not really seeking treatment, I think that really propelled and made worse my depression and anxiety.
Okay, so in seventh grade, I was diagnosed with moderate depression and generalized anxiety disorder. So one day after school, I had dance class, and I was just going through the motions of what I was supposed to be doing in class, and all of a sudden, I just felt like I couldn't breathe. My hands became cold and tingly, and the more I focused on these unpleasant sensations, the more shallow my breaths seemed to get. I got dizzy and my heart felt like it was gonna come out of my chest. And I just had this overwhelming sensation that my throat was closing up and I was gonna die. I asked to leave class early and went to a neighbor's house to wait for my mom to pick me up. And I think this is common with a lot of people when they suffer from panic attacks, which is what I just experienced. When they have it for the first time, they think something's gotta be physically off with me. I never thought that it could be the result of a mental illness, but I was wrong. I just experienced my first panic attack. And soon after this, my panic attacks became much more frequent, especially because during that time, I was having rough times in school with bullying and other things of that nature. And as I said before, I mean, anyone who's ever experienced a panic attack, it's probably one of the most terrifying feelings in the world, and I just, every time I would have one, I just didn't think I was gonna make it or survive and get through it. And the physical and emotional toll that these panic attacks and this anxiety that I had took on me started to manifest itself into me developing depression. And I was always agitated every day, and every day was an effort just to get through with the constant anxiety and not knowing when you're gonna have a panic attack. And that definitely takes a huge toll on your psyche. And I felt like an outcast and that I might never recover from this disorder and this disease that I didn't even fully know about. And I was just very much trapped inside my own head. So now we want to turn, for this first section for Dark Days, we want to turn a question to the audience. So we want to know, what do you guys feel like it's like to be around someone who's really anxious or sad or depressed? What is that like as a peer or friend experiencing that?
I would say it's hard because you're trying to be there for someone that you care about, and then knowing that as much as you try, your efforts aren't going to be there because it's hard for them to change what you're trying to make them see. So I would say it'll be difficult.
Thank you.
Ready to acknowledge, or he's not ready to seek help. I just know a person, you know, he's very depressed and he's very stressed out, but we don't know how to approach him. He's not ready to accept or acknowledge, and he's very close one, you know.
Yeah.
So it's very sad to see, and like, you know, we don't know how to approach him to accept, you know, what he's going through.
And that's a very difficult thing to be there. And I would say, just from my personal experiences, just even if you can't do anything, obviously it's that person's choice, you can't force them into anything. I found that it's always really important that for the person with a mental illness or dealing with a mental health concern, that you're there, that they know you're there as some kind of support.
Yeah, but is there any way we can make him agree to get some help, you know, or like, because he's not ready to accept, like, you know, he's sick. So is there any way we can help him out or get him medical help?
I would say that this problem that you're presenting is definitely a complicated one. And I think we'd both love to talk to you about it afterwards. But I just want to say right now, I guess just to kind of hold you over, just the fact that I see the concern in you, and I see how you're definitely, like, interested in helping this person, and I think just that fact stands alone for your dedication, and I think that that's very admirable, so.
So, like, I want to say that basically being around a person who does have a mental illness, it can bring you down as well. Because it is very, like, upsetting. I've had friends who had multiple personality. I have friends who were really depressed. And being around them kind of broke my heart. Not only because they're upset, but because I felt helpless. I felt like I can't help them. So I think this is why I became, like, a psychologist. I want to become, you know, a psychologist. And also because I went through a lot of, like, depression. I was suicidal. So being around people, they can judge a lot, and I feel like if they give a handout to people are more likely to want to get the help. And I feel like that's why a lot of people don't get the help, because of the stigma that is put on a lot of people. But I do feel that being around people just makes me feel helpless, not just upset, just helpless.
And thank you so much for sharing that. I mean, it is a very sticky issue, and I don't think we're really in a position to offer, like, personal advice, but, I mean, again, just be there as a support. And just to echo what you said, I mean, when I was going through these phases of, like, feeling depressed and being really irritable, I mean, I wasn't a fun person to be around to. I mean, and I think it really shows you a lot when those people do stick by your side, even in those really bad times. So I think we have time for one more.
And I think it's important just to have a person there to talk to also. Because I did almost suffer from depression in high school. And I used to always go to my counselor, and she was like, why you still, like, she didn't really understand, like, I did have a lot of friends, but I had, like, anxiety attacks, like, during school, when taking tests and exams, so, well, just for her being there and listening to my stories was helpful to know that she was there, and that support is better off than just, like, maybe wanting the person to just look at a different perspective. I know that's hard for that person to do that.
So We'll now move on to the next part of this presentation, and this one is labeled acceptance. So we're going to talk about our own acceptance of mental illness and mental health concerns, you know, what that means to us personally, what we've done, and how we feel about it. So I'd say right off the bat, just to start, acceptance was very hard for me, and I think this ties into a lot of what the other speakers were saying, because of stigma. I mean, like I said, of course, it took a long time to kind of convince myself that something was wrong and that this was really stopping me from doing a lot of things in my life, and it was causing me not to function as well as I wanted to. And this stigma really affected me because I didn't want to think, I didn't want to feel shameful about it. I didn't want to appear weak, and I think my conceptualization of what mental illness was at that time, as like a 15, 16-year-old, was that mental illness is crazy. And I was like, I don't want to be crazy. I mean, I'm not like this. It was a constant thought process of kind of to really figure out what was going on. And it was really, like I said, this why question. Like I said, I'm a pretty logical person, or at least I was. And I was like, well, nothing's really going on, so I can't link this to what's going on here. And I think part of this acceptance process was learning that mental illness is really, or can be the result of so many different factors. You can't really pinpoint it. It is very difficult. And I'd say overall, my acceptance really hinged on three things, and that's treatment, education, support. I'll get into treatment a little later in another section, but really quickly just, I think there's a big difference between knowing something's wrong with you or knowing something is going on that you can get assistance with and become like a better version of who you are, and actually doing something. And that step, that bridge of actually doing something, was a big part of acceptance for me. In terms of education and support, I think education really goes two ways. For me, it was both self-education, and now being part of NAMI on campus and being around all these collaborations and being able to educate others. First, self-education really taught me a lot about different treatments that were available, different medications, and obviously this was helped by the mental health professionals that I worked with. And then in terms of support, support was a really interesting thing for me because a lot of what I learned about social anxiety disorder at the beginning was just Googling it. Googling like anxiety in social situations, and I finally came across it and I saw like the DSM and I was like, this is me. And then I finally found a forum for social anxiety, and this was really an interesting moment. I find this forum on Google, and I'm looking around, and I scroll to the bottom of the page, and there are 100,000 members on this forum. And I think that was a really powerful moment for me, just knowing that like you're not alone, other people are going through this, or at least other people care about this, so this is a real thing. That was really huge for me. And again, support. Support isn't always easy. I think when you talk about mental illness with people that are close to you, there is an opportunity, there's a chance that there's going to be a mixed reaction. Luckily, I've had a lot of supportive people around me. There are still some people who kind of don't really understand, but I think part of acceptance is respecting that, or at least knowing how to deal with it when it comes up, and people really are like, is that really true, or what's going on there? So acceptance is really a huge thing. And just to finish here, I think just the way I see myself, and again, this why question I kept asking myself. And I think through all three of these things, treatment, education, and support, have really helped to mitigate that why, or at least try to gain an understanding of what's happening, or just accept that this isn't my identity, this isn't all of who I am, this is a part of me, this is something that I can receive treatment for, this is something that I can better for myself. And yeah, that's what I would say in terms of acceptance.
Okay, so Joe just kind of touched on this at the end of his acceptance. But to me, acceptance was always about being at peace with my diagnosis and knowing that my mental illness is a part of me, but that it doesn't have to be who I am. So at first, I was terrified as to what admitting that I had this mental illness would mean for me as a person. I was always worried that I would be known to myself and to others as the depression and anxiety girl. And grappling with this was really difficult for me. A part of me, even at this early point, knew on some level that I didn't have to be defined by this disorder, but at the same time, I was frustrated that this would be something that I would have to live with. And at that point, I was struggling with the strong desire of wanting to be normal again, or at least what I thought normal was. But at the same time, I knew that in order to break free from this shame surrounding my illness, I would have to embrace it in a sense. And I think the person that was probably the most instrumental in helping me do that was my mom. So we have a lot of mental illness in my family, and she had struggled with depression and anxiety herself. So she never looked at me as different or bad for having this disease. She always looked at it as just a problem to be solved and a problem that she would help me solve. And she never saw it as something that would drastically alter or ruin my life. And she helped me to be at peace with the fact that this was a part of me, but it was nothing more than that and nothing less than that. And she helped me to kind of make my own definition of normal. And at this point, I knew that if normal meant that I had a mental illness, then that was okay with me. And so with the help of my mom and the rest of my family and becoming educated about my own mental illness, I've come to accept it and finally be comfortable in my own skin and happy in my own skin. And now the question we have for you guys again for this section, how do you think you as a friend or peer could help a friend or peer who is struggling with acceptance of their own mental illness?
Thank you. I think the best way is to come out myself. I've actually helped some. I'm a college professor, and I have depression, a major depressive disorder. And one of the reasons why you guys, and I told you this already, I so admire you, is that you're kids, and you're going public with this. And I think that takes a lot of courage. And I did not have that courage. And I did not have that courage as an adult until I got tenure. So, my colleagues did. So your stories were so painful for me to listen to, because I've seen that and experienced some of that discrimination. And but I think that what you guys are doing here tonight is tremendous. And one of the things I've noticed when I've told my own students who come see me, and they're very troubled, and I send them to the Health and Wellness Center, and I've had responses talking about stigma of, oh, I'm not crazy. And I've said, and I just, one of the ways to help people accept themselves is to be an example yourself. And I've said, well, I have depressive disorder, and counselors have really helped me. I think that, you might want to give it a shot. So to be open about your own struggles, like you guys are all doing tonight, is amazing. And I just really applaud you for it. Whoops.
You're good at this. Anyway. Yeah. Thank you.
My best friend, she suffers from depression herself, and she has been suicidal several times, and what have been helpful, in my opinion, is that I try to stay positive and strong, like you said, and actually I can assure her that she's not alone, and that
you can hear me?
Yeah. And that there are actually other people in a worse situation than they are, and that things are not as bad as she sees them, and I am, happy to be there twice and be able to help her out of it. To the point that, she's an officer, so that's a really scary situation. And I still, try to wait for things to help her, that to reassure her that that is not the end of the world. But she still don't want to accept it, doesn't want to seek help either. So as a friend, it's hard. Because I'm not a professional, but, from reading and Googling things, that's how I'll be able to manage to help my friend out for the past 10 years.
Thank you.
All right, hello. I think one of the things that I've just, coming from high school 4 years ago, now that I'm a junior here, one of the things is listening, right? I feel like when my friends or friends that I've had, they're struggling with acceptance, It's because nobody will listen to them, or as soon as they start talking, they get labeled, and right, and it's one of the things that they won't accept. They don't have the opportunity to accept their own what they're thinking or their own mental illness, because we keep hearing they think they're crazy, right? They think that there's something wrong with them, so they're not going to accept it because nobody will listen to them. So one of the things that if you're trying to react when your friend is trying to accept or going through this time, is sometimes it's not your time to say something, just to listen to them so that they feel that they have that support so that they can accept it. Not, you know, you're not in their shoes to be doing that anyways. Just listen to them so that you can know how to handle a situation before you even take the step to even speak to them about it. So I think that's one of the important things.
And thank you also much for sharing that. I think that all your friends or all the people that you talk about are very lucky to have someone like that in your life. And I think that really ties in to NAMI's campaign going on right now, which is I Will Listen. That one in four people may struggle with a mental illness, but like Paul says, four in four can listen. I think just being able to listen, being able to be non-judgmental, and just being there, I think that's so powerful. So, thank you. Regarding treatment. Okay. So this next section that's part of the segment is treatment. And like I said, treatment for me really began after I graduated from high school. And this was due to a couple of things, me not really knowing what was going on, I guess other people in my life not really understanding or feeling comfortable suggesting it to me. So really at the end of high school, after I graduated, that was the first time I sought treatment. And a couple of interesting things were happening around the time that I was thinking about getting treatment. One thought process that was going on was, all right, maybe this was just a high school thing, or college will be different. But that changed very quickly when I actually put money down to dorm at a private school, and I got my schedule, and I saw I had a speech class. And I think that was just one thing, and I was like, I'm not ready for this. I don't know if I could do this. I think this really is a problem, and I don't want this to continue on into college. For all of this to continue happening, that was really one of the impetuses to finding treatment. And I remember how it happened. I kind of asked my mom in passing, like, "When's the next time I have to get a checkup with the doctor?" And she was like, "Oh, you just got one recently." I was like, "Well, I think I need to see him." And she's like, "Why?" And then it was a really awkward conversation, so you can tell. And I mentioned that I think I'm going through this anxiety, feeling really down, having you noticed this. And I do have to say that both my parents were very supportive of it. They set up an appointment with the doctor, general practitioner. Our family doctor recognized it right away, thankfully. I think my Googling helped to kind of told them. Anyway, he actually set me up with a social worker. We kind of went from there. I started on an antidepressant. I really started at the end of high school that summer before I started college. I don't think I was in place at that point to actually dorm. So I actually declined that private school, came to John Jay. So glad I did. And just to talk about the treatment more specifically, it really has been a journey, because I don't know how many of you know, but kind of finding the right medication sometimes can be an experiment. Just finding the right medication that fits, with your biology, finding one that doesn't give a lot of side effects. And I did eventually find one that was working pretty well. It kind of lessened my depressive symptoms. I felt less anxious in certain situations. And I think the therapy that I was part of really helped to adjust my thinking and really see things in a different light, which was extremely helpful. And just in terms of stigma on a larger level, I would also like to mention in terms of treatment, that actually not too long ago, it was actually a year ago to this date, I got a letter in the mail from my insurance company, and they let me know as nicely as they could, that they would no longer be covering psychiatric services for me. So I had to switch off the medication I was on that I was doing pretty well on, switched to a different one, and I kind of went through a bad phase at that point. I eventually got in another one that kind of kept me stable when I was doing better on it, and thankfully I am now. But just the whole thing, and I know we talked about it a little before in terms of mental health parity, and that's still something that we're really working on. There has been some exciting news lately, but still so much more that we can do to bring mental health on the same level as physical health. And really, again, just to finish off on treat, I really have to thank the mental health professionals that I've worked with. There have been some really great ones who kind of just put everything out there for me, let me know the different treatment options, the medications, what I can expect, what could happen. Anything that really put me in control, able to pick, kind of pick the best treatment for me and kind of go from there. And so that's my treatment story.
Okay, so in terms of treatment for myself, at first I was very hesitant about receiving any type of treatment for my mental illness, even though at that point in my life I had accepted the fact that I had this mental illness, I was still wary about what treatment would entail. I had no idea what to expect, and that's a very scary feeling. And at the time, I had already been seeing a therapist for a couple years, and she was really a critical part in having me look into seeing a psychiatrist and starting to go on an antidepressant. And I did this with the help of my family and the support of my family, and I found that my personal combination of going to therapy and taking medication worked really well for me. But this doesn't mean that the decision was an easy one to make. When the suggestion from my therapist at the time of medication was first brought up to me, it was really scary. I had heard that psychiatric medication can alter like your whole personality or make you like a zombie. But at that moment, I looked back on how this disorder that I had made me a completely different person, but in a very negative way. And I decided that any of those kind of horror stories that I had heard about medication were worth the risk for me to take. And luckily, these negative side effects that I had heard of never happened with me, and I've actually feel like I've been really blessed in the fact that I really have very minimal, besides getting tired, you know, every now and then from the antidepressant I take, I have very minimal side effects with my medication. And I can fix the minimal ones I do have, or I've been able to fix them by just adjusting my dosage as myself and my psychiatrist see fit. And my antidepressant really got me to the state of mind I needed to be in order to face the obstacles that I had in front of me. And this treatment plan got me back to being me. I started on a small dose of an antidepressant and was slowly moved up as my doctor felt was right for me and what I felt was right for me. And today I go to psychotherapy twice a week with a different therapist. To continue working on myself and recognizing what I need to feel, to have that feeling of being comfortable with who I am as a person. And psychotherapy, at least up to this point in my life, I feel like has been the best option for me, and it's been rewarding in a lot of ways. It gives me the opportunity to really explore my thoughts, feelings, beliefs, and behaviors. And I've been lucky in my life to really get to work with great therapists that I feel like I have a good connection with, and I think going into therapy for the first time is really scary for anyone, no matter what you're going there for, and I definitely didn't spill my guts to my therapist the very first session, or even the second one, or the third one, but as you kind of build up that trust with this person, you feel like you can disclose more, and I started to talk more and more about my personal experiences, and I was lucky enough to have therapists that were great at handling all of the problems I faced and all of the good things I faced and all of the bad things I faced, and that really helped to build trust between us. And I became more trusting of them and more trusting of the treatment, and I was able to go on in this way. So now the question we have for you guys is, what elements do you personally feel make up an effective treatment plan?
I feel like the most important element that makes up an effective treatment plan is the person being serviced, being involved. Because you guys have amazing stories about having great therapists and people working with you and people telling you your options, and a lot of people don't get that at all.
Yeah.
Like, so I think that it's like the word you use, like blessed, like very, because I'm the youth advocate that Paul was talking about, and I advocate for youth within the mental health system, or pretty much cross systems actually. And this is like a big thing that we advocate for, because like I have youth who feel like they're like rats in the lab, instead of being given like alternatives and things of that nature. So I think the first thing is the youth or the person being serviced, being involved, being a part of an active part of their treatment plan.
What elements do you feel make up an effective treatment plan?
Okay. My personal experience is a little bit difficult because I myself was involved in a car accident last June, and then a few months ago I was diagnosed with PTSD, and I'm trying to figure that same thing myself because I've seen several therapists, and it seems like you're saying it's very scary, and I don't feel like taking medications. I think like I could just try it on my own. And I actually started taking some antidepressants because I was very scared about, like, oh my God, like I'm an addict, and I don't know. And I was just very scared of the fact of using medication. So the antidepressants, yes, they are helping, but then again, the side effect is very overwhelming. When meaning that I'm a student, a graduate student, and I'm the mother of two, single mother of two, it's like I feel like I'm fighting a battle on a daily basis. So I don't know if I should keep going forward with this or there's any other thing that can help me. So like you say, maybe I haven't had someone that I feel comfortable enough to open up, and maybe they could help me in a better way by just, you know, after a year, instead of taking medication, I'm supposed to find out what it's really that I need. So I think one good thing is having a good, you know, practitioner be by your side.
And thank you both for sharing that. I would say from my personal experience, at least, it's very unique to the person, what kind of treatment you need. But I think, as was echoed over here, that just having the options and having that control, or being able to weigh the different options and feel like you're in that decision, I think is so important. So thank you both. Okay, so the next section is on coping skills, and I'll kind of start with my story here, and that's beyond the therapy and the medication that I've used on and off, and do currently use and see a therapist. There are many other things that I've used to cope with my mental illness, cope with mental health problems, and just to name a couple, I think for me, exercise is been great, kind of gets the endorphins going, reduces some stress. Meditation, as difficult as it is, just trying to do that from time to time, or just having some own time to myself and just kind of reflecting. And tying into that, one thing that really helps me out is journaling. For me, I feel like putting my thoughts down on paper, I'm able to put it in some kind of tangible form, it's down somewhere, I'm able to reflect on it. I don't have to think about it, it's there, I can look at it. So that has really helped as well. And also in terms of coping, this kind of ties into what I talked about before, and that's kind of education. I really believe being involved with John Jay and taking courses and kind of getting involved in these intellectual discussions and being able to talk with people about it, share my ideas, listen to other ideas. That's been a really powerful thing for me. And lastly, in terms of coping, this again goes hand in hand with that support system. Having people around you who are comfortable to say, like, oh, you're looking a little stressed out, maybe you should calm down a little bit, or you're looking a little anxious there. Just people around you that that can be supportive and that can be comfortable enough to say that to you. And then I think also helping to run this campus, this club rather, on campus, National Alliance of Mental Illness on campus, our club here, and being able to kind of share this knowledge with other people and raise mental health awareness and destigmatize mental illness. I think this has all helped in terms of coping for me.
Okay, so in terms of coping for me, I would say I cope by first and foremost utilizing my family and friends when I need support of any kind, whether it has to deal with my mental illness or not. I find that just being able to talk to someone that's going to non-judgmentally listen to you is a very cathartic experience. And knowing that I have all these options of someone to talk to is comforting. It helps to remind me that I'm not alone. And I think also one positive thing, and probably something that I'm thankful of for having depression and anxiety, would be that I'm hyper aware of what specifically causes me to become stressed out. And I use this skill to know what my limit is in terms of the responsibilities and other obligations I take on, some of which can be stress-inducing or anxiety-inducing. And I also find, in terms of stress, that doing at least one small relaxing thing a day helps me to feel more at peace within myself. And as counterintuitive as it may seem for someone with an anxiety disorder, I really love scary movies a lot. I talk to them about Joe all the time. He wants me to stop, so but I'm not going to. He gets freaked out. Anyway, so watching scary movies I find to be relaxing because it's an escape. Which is kind of all-encompassing, and it's impossible for me when I'm in the thick of it to kind of worry about any of my own problems, so I get to just escape, and because, you know, it's like, oh, well, I have anxiety, but this girl's about to get her head chopped off, so, I mean, you know, you level it out. But most importantly, I realized not to sweat the small stuff. I realized that I'm not perfect, and this fact does not make me any less of a person. I think, in fact, this fact makes me a happier person and a more grounded person. And I also try to have a good sense of humor about my experience and even about myself in general. And doing this makes my hard times, when I do have them, a little bit easier and reminds me that even if I have a struggle, it's not the end of the world. So now the question for this section is, does anyone have any questions for either of us on coping skills? I think we can only take one because we're running a little behind.
Organized, or I try to be. So after being diagnosed, I feel like I'm all over the place, like I don't have enough time to do anything like I used to before. So I'm really having a difficulty with my time management. Like I could put it in a calendar, and I just forget that I put it on a calendar, and then they wonder what it's for. So like, and then I obviously can walk around with something in my hand, reminding me every moment what it's next. Like I almost forgot I was going to come here, but I'm here. So
well, you didn't forget.
So yeah. What advice in a management, you know, time management?
Yeah, no, I can totally agree. Don't worry. Got me.
Yeah.
Well, I know that, like, I write down things all the time in my little date book, and then I forget them. And sometimes I remember them if I remember to look at my date book. So, no, but I think that... I mean, this is, I guess, going to sound like kind of generic answer, and we can definitely talk about this more after the presentation because it's a complicated thing, but I think that everyone has their own way that's relative to them of, like, how they can help with time management, and I think especially, even if you don't have a mental illness, time management is hard for everybody everywhere. So I think it's just about finding something that works for you and that doesn't cause you undue stress, but at the same time keeps you on track. And I think it's hard, but I think it's just about finding that thing. And maybe that thing isn't writing in a date book, or maybe it is, or maybe it's something in between. But I think it's all about finding what works for you, if that answers your question.
Thanks a lot. So the next and actually last session is entitled, like Amalia said earlier, Successes, Hopes, and Dreams. So when thinking about this and when thinking about writing it, I kind of started out with learning to live with my illness has shown me a lot about my own resilience. I stand here today, for example, sit here today, in front of a large group of people, and this is something that was unimaginable a couple of years ago. I mean, small talk was brutal. This is, I'm so glad that I was able to co-found NAMI on campus here and be able to kind of pay it forward and raise mental health awareness and let people know that these conditions are real, that treatment is available. And with this, I've got to meet so many awesome people, work with so many great people, and it has really been awesome. And just in terms of academics, I'm really proud to be continuing my education. My goal is to be a clinical psychologist. I'm hoping to start a PhD program next fall, fingers crossed. A lot of the research I'm doing right now is very relevant to what I'm passionate about, and that is mental illness stigma. Serious mental illness, both as independent topics and together, as well as the criminalization of mental illness, and kind of how that plays a role in our criminal justice system. And it really feels so great to be able to dedicate myself to something that I'm so passionate about, advocating mental health awareness, just being involved in all of these activities. And I guess I say my overarching hope is that by doing these Inner Own Voice presentations, starting a discussion, kind of bringing mental illness to the forefront, being able to talk about it, that I can in some type of way break the barriers to self-help and effective treatment, educate those in mental health awareness. And this is guided by a real firm belief, and that belief is that no one should ever have to feel alone or afraid to speak up for help. And I would just say that it's okay.
Okay, so for me, success is being able to live my days without the fear and stress that I used to, or that used to rule my life. At this point, I've gotten into like the top choice I had for the college I wanted to go to. I've found meaningful relationships, and I've excelled in my schoolwork. And I've accomplished more things in my life than I ever thought I would as a confused and scared 12-year-old. Today, I'm confident and know where I'm going. I go to school for psychology, and a big reason I've chosen to study this is because of my own problems that I've had to face with my mental illness. I'm able to do work with a great organization, NAMI, and lead a club at my school that bases its whole mission around fighting stigma and helping individuals who find themselves in situations similar to mine. And in the future, I see myself working with people that have mental illnesses and who have been involved in the criminal justice system. I know just from having my own mental illness how debilitating stigma, both internal and external, can be. And I wanna work with those people who have not been able to break free of this stigma surrounding their illness. I wanna be an advocate for people who may not have the strongest voice. I know how hard my mental illness has been, but I also know that recovery is possible. And it's a future goal of mine to pass this knowledge on in order to show others like myself that there is, in fact, hope. Before this part of the evening wraps up, I'd like to leave everyone with a quote that I came across the other day in reading an article I had to read for one of my other classes. And I really think it speaks to what Joe and I are doing here tonight and what everyone is doing here tonight, and what sharing these types of experiences is really about. So it's by a writer named Audre Lorde, and it goes, quote, "I have come to believe over and over again that what is most important to me must be spoken, made verbal, and shared, even at the risk of having it bruised or misunderstood, that the speaking profits me beyond any other effect. The fact that I am here and that I speak these words is an attempt to break that silence and bridge some of those differences between us. For it is not difference which immobilizes us, but silence." And I'd just like to thank everyone again for coming out and giving us your time tonight. You guys have been great sports. And it means a lot to both of us. And I guess, does anyone have any final questions before we can eat?
Yay. Sorry, last note. As far as the whole stigma thing and everything you guys are talking about as far as coping, the best thing I've found is education and also a rearrangement of perspective. As far as I'm concerned, anywhere there's a deficit, there's also a benefit. So for instance, someone who is born blind ends up having a very acute sense of hearing. On top of that, someone who loses their legs ends up having really, their arms are very versatile. In the same way, for instance, as far as bipolar disorder, yes, you have this deficit where you're constantly going through this depression, but they've also found links to that in creativity. And any suffering that you're going through, you're gaining resilience. You're also experiencing a heightened awareness that people who are not experiencing this are not experiencing. On top of that, it's likely that a lot of people who are doing psychology, going to school for psychology, I would imagine, although it is silent, a lot of them have experienced mental illness and pain. So as far as changing around the stigma, there are psychiatrists who are mentally healthy and are not mentally ill, in which case, God bless them, they are trying to help people like us. But by increasing the amount of people who are mentally ill in this field, I compare it to when one of my friends went through a death of someone in the family. And I didn't know what to say, because I haven't had to experience, thankfully, a death in my family since I was six, and I didn't really remember that. But when someone is experiencing a depression, I do know what to say, because I know what people would say to me that make me feel better, and I know what they can do to make me feel better. So people like us getting to this and helping other people, I think we have the advantage in the sense that when people come to us in pain, just by having experienced it ourselves, we have the ability to put ourselves in that person's shoes. And for that reason, we have that advantage, and we can help them because we've been living in this, and we know what to say. So I think it's all a rearrangement of perspective. And educating myself on this, I learned that it's something that's part of you, and yes, but it is something that's part of you in an amazing way, not in a bad way. There's so much you can get from experiencing this suffering, and if you can rearrange your perspective in that way and know that yes, you have a deficit, but you also have something that people who do not experience this cannot experience this. And I think it's important that we utilize that to help other people that are like us.
Have you ever considered being an inner own voice speaker? Just saying, because that was amazing. Thank you.
I was going to say that what you're highlighting is the peer movement. I mean, if you look at the mental health system, there's many, many decades of oppression of people being told who they are, being forced to do things. And luckily within the system, there's now peer specialist positions where people who live a life of recovery can actually work within the system to promote change and advocate for people. There's still a lot of work to be done because some of these positions they're finding are more like just put in because they're put in and they're not actually being given the voice that they should be given, but it's a whole movement. And if anyone wants to look up, you know, or just research the peer movement, it's really more than important. It's crucial.
So I want to thank Joseph and Amalia for sharing your amazing stories. Courage, and I really admire you for doing this and for standing up here, and also all of you who shared your personal little moments that related to mental illness. I also want to thank the rest of our guest speakers, Mary Beth and Caitlin and Paul. Thank you so much for being here tonight. I really appreciate this. And there is a full course meal waiting for you in the back since we kept you so late. But before we do that, we also have a raffle ticket. Everybody, I think, got raffles when you walked in tonight. So we are giving away, actually, Caitlin is giving away a copy of her book. We only have one raffle winner. The rest of you, if you're interested in her book, she has brought copies, and they will be available for sale up here while we mingle and eat. So will you do the honors of selecting the winner of our raffle tonight? Get your raffle tickets out. Let's check those numbers.
Okay, so it is 759-2844.
Anybody have that number?
Anybody have that?
Yes, Shamara. We have a winner in the back.
That's good.